Bam, Mr. Taru. Okay, we're going to do a video learning how to display or put complex numbers, A plus, you know, values like A plus BI, into polar form. In another video, we're going to learn how to multiply and divide those complex numbers in polar form. And then finally, in a third video, introduce the Dumois theorem, which hopefully I'm not butchering that name too much, and which will show us how to take complex numbers in polar form and raise them to a power and find a root. But for right now, let's get the basics down. We have a number, a complex number, and it's 2 minus 3i, and we would say that that was in rectangular form. I have that point displayed on a rectangular coordinate system. Well, actually, it's rectangular, but it's the imaginary plane where the horizontal axis, instead of being what we would normally think of as the x-axis, is the real component of the complex number, and the vertical scale is the imaginary part. So we got 2 minus 3i displayed as going from the origin right to and down 3, just like we would do if this were just a simple rectangular coordinate of 2 minus 3i, where you would go right to and down 3. So when you're looking at complex numbers, the real portion of the complex number acts as your, kind of like your x-coordinate would, and the imaginary coefficient is going to act as your y-coordinate, just as a tie-in. Okay, so the real value is horizontal, and the imaginary coefficient is your vertical component, which we've known up until now as, you know, y, but it's b. Okay, so we want to find the absolute value of z. And a formula for finding absolute value is the square root of a squared plus b squared. Well, you might be going, that looks very, very familiar to another formula I've learned, which is r is equal to the square root of x squared plus y squared. You would have seen this formula, well, you've seen it probably since you started studying trigonometry, but we just did a video about converting between polar coordinates and rectangular coordinates, and, you know, converting points and equations. This formula was in those videos. That is, and it's basically just Pythagorean theorem, really. And these two formulas look exactly the same, except for instead of dealing with real values, we're dealing with the imaginary and the real values, or these complex numbers. And so we're going to take x squared out and y squared out and replace them with the values of x squared plus y squared, so it'll be a squared plus b squared. And indeed, I'm going to make it, well, let's just do it now. R equals the square root of a squared plus b squared. There's another formula that we learned, and we've known for quite a while now in trig, which is the tangent of theta is y over x. Well, those labels are good for rectangular form of real values, but since we're using complex values and it's real imaginary, or what moves horizontally and what moves vertically is going to be b over a. And let's see, y is equal to r sine theta. Well, y, the vertical movement in a complex number, is b. And then we have A is equal to R cosine theta. So we're kind of just really just changing the labels, but yet everything is acting the same as it was in just the real rectangular coordinate plane. And the absolute value of a complex number is simply how far it is away from the origin. You should be recognizing this as either R or, again, Pythagorean theorem. So this comes out to be the square root of A, the real part, 2 squared, plus b, the imaginary coefficient of negative 3. That comes out to be the square root of 2 squared is 4 minus negative 3 squared, excuse me, plus negative 3 squared, which is 9, or the square root of 13. So the absolute value of z in this example is, oh, I forgot my absolute value symbols. Absolute value is the distance that the point is away from the origin. And as a distance, we want to make sure that comes out to be a positive answer. Because, you know, the square root of 13 could be you know, positive or negative 3 point something, and we want to make sure we keep that positive answer. So the absolute value of z is going to be the square root of 13. Technically, the absolute value of the square root of 13. Okay, so that's how you find the absolute value of a complex number. It's just really the distance that point is away from the origin, and we've been doing that kind of calculation now for a very, very long time. We're going to now introduce the formula to get this complex number into polar form, and that is going to be z is equal to r times the cosine of theta plus I sine theta. So how do we get 2 minus 3i, this imaginary complex number, into polar form? Well, we have a real portion acting very similar to a z, x value. We have an imaginary coefficient acting very similar to a y coordinate. We have these new conversion formulas, which we recognize from converting between polar and rectangular form, and thus getting this complex number into this polar form is going to be exactly the same with different letters as going from rectangular form to polar form of just a regular coordinate. So, all that being said, we now know how far the point is away from the origin, square root of 13 units. Now we need to know what theta is. So, the tangent of theta is equal to y, which is, or b, negative 3 over 2, and theta is equal to, therefore, the inverse tangent of negative 3 halves, and off the top of my head, that comes out to be, where's it at? Negative 0.98. Now, one thing I just forgot, good thing I picked up my notes here. This formula for writing a complex number in polar form is defined as theta being between 0 and 2 pi, but you can also have, well, not but, it can also be defined between 0 and 360 if you're working in degrees. You can do these in degrees or radians. I have this defined as radians, and that just means I'm going to have to refer to my notes a little bit as I make sure I get the correct answer here. Okay. So, what I want to do is, since this is in quadrant 4, I want an angle that's in quadrant 4 that has the same reference angle of 0.98 radians. So, theta is going to be 2 pi, or that one full rotation, 6.28, minus 0.98. And that comes out to be 5.3 radians, I believe. Yes. Okay. So, we found the absolute value of z, which was basically finding r. It was finding r as well. Absolute value of a complex number is the distance from the origin. R is the distance from the origin. So now we have r, and we have theta, again, defined between 0 and 2 pi. We don't want that negative rotation, at least as this is defined. So this complex number in polar form is, drum roll please, square root of 13. Times the cosine of 5.3 plus I sine of 5.3. BAM! Okay, whatever. So now that we have this number in polar form, how can we take this polar form complex number and convert it back into rectangular form? Now we know it's 2 minus 3i. But how do we take this number that is in now polar form, this complex number that's in polar form, and convert it back into just regular rectangular form? How do we even know that it's in polar form to begin with? Well, it's got trig functions in it. And how do I know these are not degrees? Because I don't see little degree marks. There's no symbol for radians. It's just whatever. It's just there. Well, if you remember how to convert between polar coordinates and rectangular coordinates, you remember that going from rectangular to polar was very simple. Whatever the calculator spit out was the answer. Because your calculator can only deal with functions. Again, I'm repeating this. So you can do the sine of any answer you want. The sine of 30 degrees, the sine of 80 degrees, the sine of 5 pi over 3 radians, the sine of 8,623 radians. Who cares? The sine function is a function. It moves along the x-axis, and for every x, there's only one y. But when you do inverse trig functions, as we did, remember we did the tangent of theta, and we didn't get 5.3, we got negative whatever it was, 0.98. We have to play with those numbers a little bit, because inverse trig functions are not really inverse trig functions. They have to be restricted. So inverse tangent, negative 90, positive 90. Inverse cosine, 0 to pi, or 0 to 180. Inverse sine only gives you negative 90 to positive 90, or negative pi over 2, positive pi over 2. But you don't have that problem with regular trig functions. All your regular trig functions act as functions. So if you want to put this back into rectangular form, I would suggest just putting the square root of 13 back through, or distributing the r value. Make sure your calculator is in the correct mode. If you're in radians, make sure you're in radian mode. Every time you hit sine, cosine, or tangent, you have to make sure your calculator is in the right mode. Otherwise, it doesn't make any difference. So, just put this in your calculator. 13 times the cosine of 5.3 is, as we know, 2. It might come out to be like 1.9999, but it's just round off error because I've only, you know, whatever. It's just round off error. So it's going to be basically 2, and then square root of 13 times the sine of 5.3 is negative 3i. So there you go. Complex rectangular form into polar form. Couple of steps. Make sure that the theta answer that you get from your calculator, it's probably not going to be the final answer, but it's a usable number. But when you go from polar form back into rectangular form, just type it in your calculator. Whatever comes out is the answer. Bam! I'm Mr. True. Go do your homework.